I believe we are on the line that begins with the Rosh Hashanah, mikol makom. In the middle of the line, Arei Sheheim Bigedem Miyucha the Chesed the Gvura Al Kol Ponyo. Which means, it says, that even though Ein Sof L'Haris Pashtuson, they can extend indefinitely, but there is nevertheless a qualitative definition. The gather of Chesed and Gvura. Attempted to understand this principle by demonstrating the principle on the human level. And that is that there is the primary human relationship that there is a recognition by all in all categories, like the teacher recognizes the students first and foremost as a human being, one human being recognizing another human being. There is no defining factor to what that means. And then, from that, come forth different qualities, such as what we call chesed and gvura, of their relationship in terms of teacher and the student. And in that itself, he said, we pointed out that there is chesed and gvura. There is the positive relationship, and then there is also the demanding qualities of gvura. Like we said, that the teacher would demand that the student know the subject correctly. And if he makes a mistake, he's reprimanded. This reprimand element, it's a gvura element, also both emanating from the same source. You're a human being, you have to do it right. Nonetheless, this is already a definitive approach, relationship. So that this ultimately comes through in the together. There's a gather, there is a definitive quality to it of chesed and gvur. Yedem yuchad chesed and gvur al kol ponim. Al kol ponim means even if you strip from it any kind of a of a specific force, even if you say that it actually is representing the overall, the bligvul element, but it's representing bligvul in a chesed and gvura capacity. This is, the Maimer is speaking the way it is in Atzilus. And we are then translating, to, in order to understand it in Atzilus, we try to understand the way it is in the human being. Why is the human being a proper means to understand the way it is in Atzilus? Just to repeat it again, very important principle. The human being has a neshamah, a godly neshamah, literally. This godly neshamah also knows the truth only, the fundamental truth only. On a much reduced and a neshama level, on a human level, but nonetheless, it's a dynamic reality. This is similar to the way it's described in Atzilus, that in Atzilus there is the kesser, there is the attic, and the attic, then afterwards, is reflected in Atzilus in the form of chochmah and chesed. Okay, let's continue inside. Okay, I hope you have the line. The line begins with the word with the recitative mikom okon, in the middle of straight in the middle of this paragraph.
Maybe it's a little off the path, but can you explain this kesser attic atzilus sequence?
Well, I can explain it from the same approach that we've just done now.
Okay.
Just like in the human being, there's a neshama. This neshama is unlimited godly reality. But the way it manifests itself in the human being is via all kinds of different faculties of seichel and midas, and machshav v'dibur u'mais. This is all coming from the same neshama. These koiches, the way they are manifest in the guf, is called koiches oir in keili. Oir in a keili. The inyan from oir in a keili we discussed, explained at great length that the keli is the means by which you correlate the air to a worldly environment. So this is the similar thing in Atzilus, in Kesser, is that which is the Atzmus, is the reality, the godly reality as it is from the godly perspective. Atzilus is how this reality manifests itself on a worldly level. But the world over there is a world of Atzilus. But it's still a worldly level because there is specific oiris and oir and kelim, and specific qualities of chochmah and chesed. All right. Okay, at the end of that line, the inyan ma shehein rak koyah hagvul hu. So we said that the kelim are not real gvul, only koyah hagvul. And what is the meaning that it's only koy hagvul? The reason we have to come back and explain to him that to him koy hagvul is in the fact that just a moment ago we said that despite the fact that they're only koy hagvul, they're actually definitive chesed and gvura. They beget them yuchet chesed and gvura al kopon. So what does it mean that they're that koyach hagvul? What do you accomplish by saying that they're only koyach hagvul? It is lishloil. It is simply to negate, which means to circumvent, saying that it is to point out that within atzilus itself, they do not limit. And we'll explain this in a moment. Continue. V'ha-chesed ad-derech moshel, even though this is chesed. For example, chesed, hu bivchines bligvul. The chesed is bivchines bligvul. It's chesed, bivchines bligvul. And then go back and then reverse that. Mikol makom, yet still, ha-reze bivchines hagbola de chesed. It still has the hagbola of being chesed and not gvura. This is inyan going back and forth. And the reason it's going back and forth is that really there is no way to pin this down. Why is there no way to pin it down? So that we will sense that we are actually learning something. You can't pin it down, so what's the point? You're going in circles. So, an interesting union, something that we already encountered in a different context, we had discussed the phenomenon of a cup being inside a basin of water. Remember that one? Mm-hmm. And we said, when the cup is inside the basin of water, the water is not really relating to the cup. Not limited by the cup. It's the same water as in the basin. How then is it that the cup is there, and the water fills the cup? How do we describe this phenomenon? The way we describe this phenomenon is this: the cup is in the water. And it does not separate the water in the cup from the general water in the basin. But it shows that the water in the basin can be correlated to a cup. It is not yet correlated to a cup at all. Because right now it completely overwhelms the cup. It fills the cup, but not that it becomes part and parcel of the cup. Okay, so let's go back and see what's so significant about this. What's the point? Let's step back a moment. The water, as we said over these days, the water is totally unbridled, unlimited. It flows on its own recognizance. Wherever it wants, it flows. its own force. How then is it that you can put the cup into the water, into the water, and now the water fills the cup, and there is a kind of a defining factor of the water by the cup, although it is not limiting it, still there is a defining factor. This is showing that the water, in its original capacity, has qualities that can ultimately be related to a cup. Even though at this moment it is still part of the whole reality. In a more meaningful muscle, even though this is correct, but in a more meaningful muscle that we can sense the meaning, the significance of this, one human being meaning another human being. They identify each other immediately. On what basis? With their seichel, with their midas? There are such people that immediately assess the other one. What kind of person is he? Do I like him or do I hate him? But that's not the normal relationship. It's a hello, shalom aleichem among human beings. You greet a human being by greeting a human being, not his qualities. This is the wholesome relationship. From this can emanate other things. But if you start off to begin with identifying, so to speak, you know, do I like him or do I hate him, you're not really talking to a human being. You haven't opened up to him, and as a result, he doesn't open up to you. But then clearly, within this stance, at this level itself, like we said, I'm going off to different muscles, but it's all in the same vein. I hope you follow it. It's much easier for you to identify. You say, Odom Shein Abayis in Yod, a human being must have a home. The minute you identify a home, you say, oh, the home, yes, the home has to have a bed, has to have a table, has to have a chair, has to have all kinds of different things. But that's not the initial identification of a home. Because the reason he has to have a home is not in order to have a place to sleep. Yeah, he has to have a home because a human being has to have a place in the world. Like I mentioned many times that the Rebbe, sometimes in the Sikha, quotes this a little bit different. Not a home, but a place for a home. Mokin Labais. Has to have a place in the world. The fact that this place will be defined, will have a home, will have four walls, and will have furnishings and so forth, that is the derivative of the signet that he has a place in the world. As we discussed many times, that a person has all the various amenities and how he behaves is also representative of his human quality. It's not only for convenience purposes. Now the Rambam says clearly that a chochem nikir, chochem means a human being the way he should be, is identifiable by every one of his activities, no matter everything that he does it in a human and in a respectable manner. How he walks, how he talks, how he sleeps, how he eats, and everything. So all of these things are derivatives of the essential reality of this human being. Which means that all of these things are contained, initially, in this. Sorry. In this initial, in this essential primary reality. But there, it's contained within the reality itself, not identified individually. So this is what we say. That there is an initial element of bli gvul of in chesed. How do you say it's chesed at this, in the same breath that it's bli gvul? Because this chesed is not present as a chesed because it was identified as chesed, but it's identified as part of the reality of atzilus itself, of higher than atzilus, of the kesser. That's like in a human being, you identify his qualities by the neshamah identity. And yet still, harei zeh b'pchinas hagbala de chesed. Even at that level, it's yakoa hagbala de chesed. Like we said here, I'm going back to the cup and the water, because there you could see it. The water it's not become part of the cup, but nevertheless it is mugba by the cup. There's only a certain amount of water inside the cup, which means that the water in the basin is subdivisible into amounts. So it's bleak wool within a specific definition. Again, I just want to give us a little sense of the significance of this. From our perspective, we continue on. It becomes even more intricate. But the significance of this is, at our level, from our vantage point, is that whatever we do, small or big, we are engaging our koiches. And through our koiches, we are engaging our neshama. And we are engaging the neshama and the one who gave us the neshama. So essentially, this is all a derivative one of the other. It's reminiscent of a give and take by the Rebbe. That somebody asked the Rebbe, a shliach, asked the Rebbe permission to go to college because he felt that this would help him develop his oratorical skills. So the Rebbe answered, and you should just remember that wherever you go, you take me with you. How was it? How was that? That which inspires continues to follow through at all levels. This will be important as we go on, even as I said, to a more difficult aspect. Let's see if I can go. Okay, so we are now on the line that begins Hagbola. It's bli gvul, and yet it has the Hagbola that it is chesed. The gam, and furthermore, may achar. This we are still discussing the effect of kelim upon the oyer. So we said the kelim are magbil the oyer, not really, but in a certain sense. It identifies chesed from gevura, and then it says furthermore, since that the peyalim beho oyer, the effect in the oyer, the kshayumshach chutz le'atzilus, that when this oyer will ultimately be drawn and translated and have the effect outside of Atzilus. Yiyya bebchines hagbola. Then the oil will be in a hagbola manner. Because we said before that within Atzilus there is no hagbola. But nevertheless, when this oil will ultimately be nimshach lechutz l'Atzilus, then the oil will be bebchines hagbola. Who affected those hagbola? This is the effect of the kingdom. Just to remind ourselves what this is all about, what are we trying to pin down? Ultimately, we're trying to pin down that the oil itself has an element of Hagbola. And we're trying to pin it down on the basis that since the oil is mislabesh in the keilim, therefore it must be that it has a element of hagbol. In order to do that, first we have to prove that the keilim have hagbol. And we had a whole difficulty with this, until we finally said, no, the keilim do not have a real hagbol, but they have the koya hagbol. And there is some kind of effect of a hagbol through the keilim. And therefore this brings it back to the conclusion, to the point, that the oil is affected by the kelim, like he says over here, even though in Atzilus itself it remains the same, but Hagbola Mechut, when it's Nimshe Mechut to Atzilus, it becomes Mugbo. In our Moshe, both from the human level, we'll have to have time for this, but from the cup and the water level, when you put the cup into the basin, the cup is not limited to water at all, but you cannot, by using the cup, you can take the cup out of the water. And what happens? When you take it out of its source, it becomes a limited, finite amount of water. And then it acquires all the definitions of water outside of the basin. That is affected by the fact that while it was still in the water, it already brought about some kind of a sense of limit. Even though at that time it was still part of the whole base.
When the cup is placed in the water, it displaces a certain amount of water. It does have an effect on the water. So that's, that in itself is bringing out a certain limitation in the water.
Right. But this thing that the cup displaces in the water, this is This is a relative thing. This is on the course. But Gashmi is this is the way it is. But conceptually, the cup does not have dimensions. It only has a form.
Okay, so then how?
This is a statement straight out of the mathematical book. I mean, in mathematics, there is a concept of something that does not have dimensions.
So what effect does it have on the water of imparting some?
It identifies a certain quantity of water.
It identifies how? By being surrounded by the water, how does it identify?
By being the water inside the cup.
Even while it's immersed?
Right.
Conceptually?
Yeah.
I...
All right, whether you agree or not, that's your problem. This is what it is. All right, this is it for this morning. Yeah, this is just this morning. Okay, have a great day.